So with that in mind, I mean, what does this tell us? I mean, I have two questions. What does this tell us about Putin or Russia in general? I mean, I guess you've maybe already answered this, but it sounds like Russia is at a crisis point, and Putin's aware of this, and it seems like a crisis that he cannot address. So here's the shiny objects.
That's right. Putin doesn't like addressing actual problems. He is not good at it. He is not a good strategic thinker. He thinks he's kind of a knee-jerk decision maker and thinks in the very short term. What he also likes to do is throw money at problems or it's a very Soviet attitude also to punish and ban as opposed to, try to find innovative solutions to deal with what, you know, he perceives as problems. So instead of kind of dealing with what he sees as a demographic crisis or crisis of legitimacy, he starts, people start banning things, which, I mean, you see this all the time in Russia. If there's a disaster, an industrial disaster, a natural disaster, the first thing the authorities do is open criminal cases.
Right.
So Putin, he came to power. He went back for a third term, immediately lost cities, especially Moscow, which is still where he lives and works. He's completely lost Moscow. He was, I think, really shaken by the protests where you had, 100,000 people coming out in the streets on the eve of his election and his inauguration. What he chose to do is he's not a very innovative guy sometimes. He went back to what he knows, which is turning inwards, playing the anti-American card, blaming the protests on the State Department, saying that all the people who had come out to protest him were paid for by the State Department. Turning inward, fanning these flames of anti-Americanism, being increasingly less cooperative with the Americans on the global stage, whereas before, during Medvedev's tenure, things got done and there was a dialogue and there was a much more cooperative spirit. It's just this kind of what he knows is the Cold War, and he's turning in on himself. But in this kind of, he's turning the country in on itself and isolating himself because he's not really good at finding other solutions. He's not an innovative thinker in that sense. He's knee jerk. He's kind of cynical. And thinks everybody else is too.
So when we see the reaction to these laws from an international perspective, I mean, they're really sort of I'm sure there are more, but there are two very prominent responses, at least from what we're seeing in this country. One has been the vodka boycott, and one has been mm-hmm. an attempt to pressure the IOC to move to cancel and move the Olympics that are set to take place in Sochi, I think is how we pronounce it, in 2014. So give me your assessment of the relative value of those based upon, and particularly from the perspective that the issue of the the homophobia, and I would say it almost goes beyond that, but how intertwined it is with this sort of anti-Western sentiment.
So I think it's the anti-gay stuff, the talk about the Olympics, the boycott, it's not getting all that much traction in Russia, in part because the activists pouring vodka into the gutters are pouring out, Latvian-owned vodka or, vodka that's produced here in the States. And it's never going to be enough to kind of make a huge dent in Russia's economy. Also, vodka is, you know, not even close to being Russia's most important export. Russia exports oil, gas, raw natural resources. Vodka is very, you know, very much at the bottom of the list. And it's probably seen as ridiculous inside the Kremlin. I think they also know that there's no chance that there's going to be a boycott of the Olympics, especially after Obama came out and said that was not going to happen, at least on the U.S. side. And that there's no chance that they'll be moved. And now, what it does is it creates an irritant around Putin's vanity project. He is obsessed with sports, in that he's a very Soviet person. He's obsessed with sports. He flew to the meeting of the International Olympic Committee in Central America to personally lobby the committee to get the Olympics in Sochi. It's very important to him. This was a huge victory for him, as was getting to host the World Cup in 2018. And, you know, this is probably quite annoying for him, that his, his moment is being tarnished by by something that is seen in Russia as, you know, a global gay cabal. And, you know, they were trying to protect Russia from this global gay cabal, and here's the global gay cabal coming out and saying, take our import, let us in, you know, let us corrupt Russia. That's how it's seen, in Russia. I think Putin sees it a little bit more cynically. I don't think he's more homophobic than the average Russian. He probably never really thought about gay people before. He just kind of is happy to use this cynically as a wedge issue, the way George W. Bush did.
So in that respect,
he's probably just quite annoyed that they're, you know, messing his special moment.
So in that respect, it's at least having some minor impact, I guess, to that extent. Related to Putin's love of sports, Michael, my producer, has been reading a book where it tells a story that he took the man without a face, I guess. He took Bob Kraft's Super Bowl ring, the owner of the Patriots. Yeah. Are you aware of that story?
I don't think that's a sports thing. That's just like prestigious bling thing. He just decided to, you know, it was a cool souvenir. It was blingy. It's clearly really valuable. And he was like, all right, thanks for the gift. And then what are you going to do? Say no, Mr. Putin, that wasn't a gift. He's right. Kind of terrifying. He's very short, but very terrifying.
Wow. That story is just amazing. Apparently he basically just said to Bob Kraft when he was visiting, like, oh, Super Bowl ring. Can I see that? And they just pocketed it. What is that?
He supposedly said, "I could kill someone with this."
Well, it's a big ring.
I could just see him doing like an evil cackle after that.
Why is the idea that Russia could be in crisis? Why is that something that should be of concern to us in the United States, beyond what has, the import of Russia within the context of international relations? Why should that be a concern to us, and should it?
Because Russia has a huge stockpile of nuclear weapons, and again, they've recently backed out of any new weapons control measures that the Americans are proposing. And their way of, again, speaking of short-term thinking, they need to modernize their military, which is hopelessly behind the times. And what they're doing instead is just, modernizing their nuclear arsenal, because that costs a little bit less. So you know, we don't want Russia to be a failed state that has a bunch of loose nukes floating around. It's also a major supplier of its recently surpassed Saudi Arabia as the largest exporter of oil. You know, it's a big player in that world. And, you know, it's the more Russia feels itself to be threatened and in crisis and disrespected, the more it starts sticking sticks in the wheels of American foreign policy, and the more uncooperative they become. So, and that is a real concern as the Middle East kind of continues to explode.
And lastly, I want to touch on Snowden and just sort of give me your sense of how that played out. And at this point, you know, it's necessary for me to say that I will not shout you down as we discuss this, despite despite the fact that I have aspirations to go further in my career. But tell us, like, you know, give us your sense of what of just how, I mean, it seems to me that in many respects Russia was got trapped into in the same way that Snowden got trapped in Russia got trapped with Snowden, and by a set of circumstances. Just give me your sense of that.
So I think what happened is Snowden did a really poor job planning his escape. You know, if I were him, I would have gone to Iceland and then released all of the stuff. But he also undermined his credibility by going to places like China and then Russia. I think he got to China, to Russia, because the Chinese basically rolled him out of there. They didn't want that problem. And I think Assange took him through Russia. He has close ties with Russia. And I think the Russians were happy to have him there, you know, for the 21 hours that he was supposed to be there. Originally, that was the length of his original layover, so they could, you know, vacuum up his information and, you know, have him get out of there. I think they saw it as a very low-cost opportunity to stick it to the Americans and get some valuable intelligence. Then the Americans revoked his passport. They, Ecuador, who was supposed to take him in, gets a call from Joe Biden and immediately says, you know, we don't want Snowden. And every other country that Snowden starts applying to says, we're not going to give him asylum. Then American allies in Europe force the plane of the Bolivian president to land. He was coming from Moscow, going back to Bolivia. And they were afraid that Snowden was stowed away on the plane. They forced it to land in Austria. And once that happened, that was it. Like, Snowden was stuck in Russia. He couldn't, if the U.S. was ready to ground planes because they thought Snowden was in them, the Russians can't, they see themselves as a superpower still, and there's no way they can let this guy out and then have him be snatched up by the Americans and, you know, tortured and put to death, which was the trope inside Russia of what would happen to him. No self-respecting superpower does that. Just like, you know, if the situation were reversed and we had Edward Snowdenovich from Russia, we wouldn't let him go. We wouldn't send him back to Russia. We wouldn't let him leave America if we thought there was a risk that that the Russians would grab him the second he was outside of our borders. I think the Obama administration kind of messed this up by ratcheting up its public rhetoric, but also boxing Putin in and leaving him no option. I think if they had taken the route of, you know, quietly doing this in the back corridors, I think it may have had a different outcome.
Because this becomes a loss of face, I guess, for Russia.
Putin.
Okay,
exactly.
And so, I mean, there was just too much machismo, I guess, on both sides to really have any movement at that point.
Well, it's not just machismo. I mean, think about what it looks like inside of Russia. The Russian press immediately seized on Snowden and started making a hero out of him, you know, saying that he was a whistleblower and he's revealing all these evil American practices, you know, and ignoring the fact that whistleblowers in Russia are routinely killed and harassed. And Russia, for all of the people who die in its jails, does not have the death penalty, and this is something that's a huge kind of propaganda tool inside Russia. Is like, oh, you know, America, you're lecturing us on human rights, but you guys have capital punishment, and we don't. So don't lecture us. You know, just like we're afraid to send people back from Guantanamo Bay who are not, not the nicest people. We're afraid to send them back to countries where they might be tortured. So, this isn't just posturing on Russia's side or America's side. I think these are real concerns. Also, keep in mind, the weapons trafficker, Victor Boot, who was snatched up by American agents in Thailand and then put on trial and convicted in New York. Before he was put on trial and throughout the trial, the Russians were demanding his extradition because he was a Russian citizen. They said, we'll deal with it. Now, whether they would actually deal with it or just let him out is a different story because he seemed to have connections at the highest levels of the Russian government. But the U.S. staunchly refused, and the Russians were extremely angry at that. And that was quite recent. That was just a couple years ago. So why would the Russians now suddenly turn it turn Snowden over? Sorry about that.
That's okay. And leaving aside, I'm not sure I agree with your assessment about Guantanamo Bay, but the concerns in terms of letting people out, if their concern was that they're going to be tortured, but let's leave that aside.
I'm not saying that's the only concern. I'm saying that's part of the calculus.
But let me ask you this. If it is one of those situations where it became just too high profile and the positions were just too easily hardened, if I'm Edward Snowden, am I concerned that in 18 months, 36 months, 48 months, whenever this starts to die down, that at one point I'm going to be quietly sent, kicked out of the country and basically left for the Americans to pick up? I mean, at one point, right, this dies down.
Yeah, I mean, this is also, look, we talked about Russian short-term thinking. They gave him a year's asylum. What is that? That's just kicking the can down the road. In a year, it's going to, like, the same issue is, this, it's going to be an issue again. It's going to be in the news again in both countries. They didn't really solve anything, and I'm sure Edward Snowden is a pretty nervous guy right now. Plus, he's in a country he's in a city that's pretty brutal, and he doesn't speak the language. I'm sure people are tailing him and constantly coming to interview him. And he doesn't know what's going to happen in a year, and I don't think the Russians know either. I think they kind of tend to kick the can down the road and hope the can disappears, and this is what they did here.
Julia Iafi, thank you so much for your time today. Much appreciated.